these directives don't sit in isolation. CE marking directives invariably interrelate with something else. They're invariably applied with one or more other directives. And the low voltage directive is no different. So commonly, the low voltage directive would interrelate for radio and telecoms equipment, R&TTE directive at the moment. The machinery directive, awful lot of electrical parts within the scope of the LVD used on electrical on machinery. And the ATEX directive, which is really machinery and electrical equipment used in an explosive atmosphere environment. So those are the three directives with safety implications for which the LVD relates. Now the R&TTE, which will be the RED when it gets republished, applies the same rules as the LVD, the same standards. It actually calls up the LVD within its scope. It says, apply the rules applying to the low voltage directive, because that's easier. So it's the same documentation, same production control requirements. The only difference it does have is it doesn't have those lower voltage limits. So it basically starts at zero. So if you do have a battery-powered radio product or wireless equipment, then the safety requirements of the low voltage directive would ignore get called back in again. Now that's fine, because actually the standards you would apply for radio equipment, whether it be mains powered or battery powered, don't differentiate between voltage. It's only the directive that differentiates. The technical standards allow you to work on all different types of equipment. Otherwise, safety requirements for radio equipment are identical to that for ordinary electrical equipment. So a nice, easy mix. The low voltage directive, as I said, the new one will have no notified bodies. The R&TT and the RED directive, when it's republished, will have notified bodies. So there may be a requirement for notified body opinion, there's an expert third-party opinion for radio equipment, even after NLF is fully in force. For the machinery directive, it's unaffected by the NLF changes because it was already written in at the start. But the clause 1.5.1 of the essential safety requirements of the machinery directive calls up the standards applicable to the low voltage directive. So although the low voltage directive itself says, I do not apply to machinery, the machinery directive says, yep, the LVD doesn't apply, but the technical requirements embedded with the LVD do. So when you're complying with the machinery directive, you'll list the machinery directive on your declaration of conformity. You don't list the low voltage directive, but you do list the technical standards that the LVD would have applied. Same documentary evidence for the LVD. Control systems for machines, again, are on electrical. They have a slightly different set of safety critical requirements, and we'll cover those a bit later on today. ATEX directive, equipment for explosive atmospheres, pharmaceutical plants, chemical processing, oil and gas industry, petrol stations, all atmosphere environments where you might get a potentially explosive gas or dust atmosphere, more common than you would think in an industrial context. That's categorised into zones, you've got and categories where the equipment is categorised as high risk, medium risk and low risk equipment, and depending on the risk will depend on how much work you need to do to demonstrate compliance and whether you can do that work yourself, like you can under the low voltage directive, or you by law need to involve a third party. Documentation's very similar to the low voltage directive, same basic principles. But the most dangerous, higher risk, medium risk equipment, all electrical equipment, must have a notified body, test the product, and be responsible for the factory surveillance, the ongoing conformity. So it's the same things, the testing needs to be done, the factory still needs to be controlled, but for ATEX, a third party supervises both of those elements. The new ATEX directive is 2014-34 EC, so just one digit away from LVD, will replace the existing ATEX directive in a matter of weeks. But just like the changes to the LVD, most of the differences are administrative. It's beefing up the enforcement and administration. Annex 1 of the Low Voltage Directive says, I do not apply to equipment for use in potentially explosive atmospheres. However, as soon as you, if you read the ATEX guidelines or look in clause 1.2.7 of Annex 2 of the ATEX directive, it refers back to those LVD standards. So just like the machinery directive, you declare against the ATEX directive, you don't list the low voltage directive, even if it, though it's been applied, but you do list the standards to which the low voltage directive has been applied. So, quick summary of the low voltage directive. Applies to most mains connected equipment, even where other directives apply. It's not just electric shock, there's a, those six key hazards we discussed earlier. Fire, mechanical, radiation, energy, chemical, and electric shock. There's a requirement to test equipment. Test reports are one of those elements in the technical file requirement. You have to have a file. It's a legal requirement to produce it. There's a legal requirement to monitor and control the production to ensure that the design, albeit compliant, actually when it comes out the factory door, also remains compliant. And it's recognising that the low voltage directive doesn't stand alone. It interacts with other directives in different ways. NLF will make it easier because the new set of directives will all use the same words and same terminology, so there'll be less opportunity for confusion. Minor changes in terms of what you need to do, but if you say it quickly, but the reality is all declarations of conformity are going to need to be reissued. They're all going to have to be conforming to the new correct type. So it is an opportunity to revisit your declarations of conformity to make sure that what you're doing is correct. And this is a version of what I was told when I first tested products 25 years ago. All equipment that you supply for test is perfectly safe, providing you don't switch it on. Okay. Let's have a look at the documentation that you need for the low voltage directive. Remembering why we're doing this, first and foremost, CE marking is about free movement of goods. It's the ability to manufacture a product in the north of Ireland and be able to sell it in the south of Spain, or into Romania, or Greece, or Germany, or France, or Denmark, without going through additional compliance checks. For the low voltage directive, it's making sure that those products, when supplied, are safe, so that the Spanish and the Italians and the Germans and the Danes aren't exposed to health hazards, dangers to themselves. So end user safety is very important. Whether that end user be you and I switching on our television sets in the evening, or switching on our computers at our desks in the morning, or working on a machine, or shopping, all those environments we covered. It's you and I they're protecting in whatever role we are performing at the time. It's a declaration of conformity supported by detailed documentation. And this detailed documentation is absolutely key to the way in which CE marking is developing under the new legislative framework. The particular documentation we've been asked to do is to show that the equipment design is safe. It's safe because it's following good engineering practice. You're an expert on the design of the product. You've put hours and hours of effort into designing it, so you know that it, whether it's safe or not. So you've applied good engineering practice, recruited engineers to do the design. And you've met those specific objectives in the back of the directive, and then by default, the requirements placed in standards. Once you've got that design, that paper compliant design, you then need to be also to be able to show that you can make it according to type as the product changes. You know, you have a design with certain components in it. What happens if a component becomes unavailable and you need to ship in a fortnight's time and the lead time is 6 weeks? What do you do? How does your quality system deal with that to ensure you don't replace a safety critical part with an unqualified part that introduces a hazard into the equipment? We've got the benefit of common documentation, so it's feasible to have a technical file that covers the range of CE marking directives, probably with separate sections for safety and EMC and radio, but core elements of your technical file will be the same. The low voltage directive in Annex 4, in the existing and the new directive, says general design of equipment shall be detailed. You shall have conceptual design drawings, descriptions and explanations necessary for the understanding of the above, lists of standards applied in full or in part, the results of any design calculations and test reports showing that you've tested your hypothetical design and proven it to be compliant. Once that's all done, then the declaration of conformity, which is the signature of the person within your organisation, saying, I have done all these things, it's been done correctly, it's been checked, and the product is suitable for supply. So, what do we mean by general description of the equipment? Well, it needs to be a relatively simple, clear description of the equipment. Really, to establish the technical file that you have in front of you relates to the particular product. If it's a range of products, how are the range variants described? So it could be as simple as clear photographs, drawings, copy of the instruction book. Quite often the instruction book describes the function of the equipment, describes the range, has got photographs in it. It just needs to be relatively straightforward so that when you present a file to an enforcement officer or they come and call, they say, yep, that's definitely the file for this product. It needs to include drawings, so conceptual design and manufacturing drawings. It doesn't need to be every single drawing that goes into the build of the product, just those key drawings that describe the safety of the design. And it may be that these are top level, that actually the second tier detailed drawings are elsewhere, and you reference them from within your file. So a first level technical product overview. So this could be electrical block diagrams, it could be exploded general assembly drawings, all the stuff that you quite commonly see in instruction sets. That's what the file needs to be, but then it needs to say, and the rest of the drawings are stored here. Probably most important in the file is that descriptions and explanations necessary for the understanding of the above. Can you understand what the product is, what its variants are, and how those drawings relate to the product range or the design that you're covering? So what does it do, how does it do it, and who uses it? Is it intended to be used only by trained persons? Is it intended to be used in the home by all members of the family? Who uses it? Is it indoor use? If it's outdoor use? And actually, what does it do? What's your intended function? Is it a laptop computer for use absolutely anywhere? Or is it a laptop computer that's only to be used in indoor locations? You decide, you specify. This may already be in your instruction set. Your front of your manuals may already describe this. But if not, just a brief description, a couple of paragraphs, to explain what it does, where it does it, who does it. And the most important thing is remembering that the person who's going to be reviewing this file, the only time it's going to be reviewed, is if a customs officer or a health and safety officer or a trading standards officer requests it. This isn't something you're going to share with your customers unless you want to. It's something that you're going to be required to present by law. But the person reviewing the file, if it's an industrial product, works for the HSE. So today he's looking at your particular piece of equipment with regard to compliance with the low voltage directive, but yesterday he was dealing with somebody who's been speared by a forklift truck, or someone who slipped off a ladder. And tomorrow he'll be dealing with something else. He isn't necessarily, he or she isn't necessarily going to be an expert on the low voltage directive. What they should be is an expert on what should go in a technical file. So if your file, you know, looks like a technical file, then actually they're going to say, yep, that looks all right to me. And unless there's reason for them to dig any deeper, they move on to something else. If your technical file is woefully inadequate, doesn't have the detail that's required as a minimum by law, well, one, he's got you. If he really feels mean, he can prosecute you for that. And the new LVD quite clearly says that that's the case. But also, it gives him an opportunity to dig. And remembering that, you know, that there's going to be pressure on UK government to enforce these new directives. So they're going to be saying to health and safety officers, you know, you make sure you can demonstrate you're being rigorous. So I'm not saying there's going to be quotas, but they're certainly going to chase down anything that looks inadequate. And if you present them with an inadequate file, you are inviting further investigation. If you present them with a good file, then less so. So remember to make your descriptions and explanations simple enough, clear enough, for a non-LVD expert to understand. You need to list the standards you've applied and fallen before, in part. As I said, the standards are your tool for proving compliance, so you may apply more than one standard, in which case, list them. If there aren't any standards, you may mix and match, or you may choose not to apply them at all, in which case you need to put a lot more detail as to why you didn't apply those standards. Any calculations or examinations of the product need to be detailed in the file, at least briefly. This is why did you think that particular critical part was suitable? What was your rationale for using that part in this application, that material? That needs to go in the documentation. At least a summary of the thought process. It might be the certificates, and backing up the spec sheets, are elsewhere. But certainly the overview needs to go in the file. Detailed component specifications. I have a part, this is why I chose it. This was the ratings I was looking for. It had these third-party approvals, and for that reason, I applied it. That's due diligence. Due diligence, having evidence-based decision making. Not, I chose this one because it was the cheapest. I chose this one because it was the only one in the RS catalogue. I chose this one because it was the only one that would fit. It needs a more detailed rationale for these safety critical parts. If you are buying in previously approved parts, previously approved sub-assemblies like power supplies, safety critical fuses, resistors, thermal devices, then the approval certificates that back it up, again, need to go into the file. Finally, test reports. This is an optional extra. You have to test. If you pick up one of these harmonized standards, it will give you a list of tests. So you should apply those tests, and the results need to go in your technical file. The test report doesn't need to be compiled by a third party. You can do it yourself, or you can choose any person who you believe to be competent to carry out these tests for you. But you're aiming to establish that the design actually complies. You've made actual measurements, physical separations, temperature measurements. As a result of the testing, you'll also come up with which parts are really critical or not. If when you are applying fault conditions, you find that a thermal fuse goes, then that thermal fuse is critical. If you do a short circuit, an ordinary fuse goes, or a circuit breaker trips, that device is critical. If you carry out a whole series of fault assessments, misuse, and those devices don't trip, then are they really safety critical? Do you need to worry about them? Are they superfluous? But those which are necessary will be drawn out of your test report, and they will be the bits that then you carry forward into more detailed control in production. If you're buying parts in from other people, if you can get them to give you the test report that underpins their compliance, then that's useful. Difficult to get sometimes, but worth asking. Things like power supplies, you will occasionally get given it. So in addition to those six elements of technical documentation, there are some logistical requirements. Your documentation must be complete. You can't just do half complete your file. It needs to be complete. It needs to be compiled by the manufacturer if you're based in the European Union. If your manufacturer is based outside the European Union, then they can appoint an authorised representative in the EU who takes on the responsibility of manufacturer de facto for the compliance of the product. If something goes wrong, they're held responsible. Or if you are not the manufacturer or their authorised representative but are just importing it, then you take on the role of compiling that file. So just because you bought it off somebody else who's already CE marked it outside the EU, if you are bringing it onto community territory, you must have the file on your premises because you are responsible for it. You can't say, it was CE marked in Brazil. They've got the file. Not good enough. You are the importer, you must have the file. If you're the author, appointed authorised representative, you have to have the file. The file needs to be kept on community territory. That does mean that you can have access to a server, perhaps overseas, with the data on it, but you need to be able to access it here. You can't say, oh, I don't have the documentation, I'll send for it from Brazil or Chile or Australia. It needs to be on community territory and accessible in a reasonable period of time. And that technical file needs to be retained for 10 years after the particular product is supplied. So if you make a series production run of products over 5 years, when that production finishes, all the technical documentation supporting that must be maintained for a further 10 years. If it's a product with a very long life, that file is going to be updated and revised by you, possibly, but perhaps, but not by you, by your successors, and they need to be able to make sense of what you've done. NLF note, the declaration of conformity must be kept up to date. I always say you could take 30 declarations of conformity, lay them on a table. You wouldn't find two that were the same, or two that were technically correct. It's a very, very poor hit rate, which is why they've put so much emphasis on getting them right and making sure that the directives don't contradict each other, which they have in the past. Some of them have had very detailed declarations, some of them very weak ones. Now they're all the same. Declarations of conformity are going to be the easy hit. If enforcement on the UK government by the European Commission is going to be an issue, what's the easiest way of increasing the number of products that you survey in the marketplace? Well, you can either go and knock on people's doors, which is expensive and labour intensive, or you can go and sample products for the marketplace, spending taxpayers' money, expensive, heavy resource. Or you can go through a trade directory, go on the internet, and just request declarations of conformity, which you can do from a desk. So the enforcement officer can go and have a look at DFCs and go, yeah, that DFC looks all right for me, that looks all right, that's completely woeful, let's put that in the pile for perhaps people we'll go and visit later, and so on and so forth. At the moment, the declarations of conformity are so varied, it's nigh on impossible for anyone to do that. But as part of the NLF changes, the intention is that it'll be much easier to spot the rogue DFCs. So do place great emphasis on that. So the LVD compliance cycle actually starts when you apply the CE mark. So you've done all these things, you've tested it, you've produced your technical file, you've applied your CE mark, you've signed your declaration of conformity, off you go. You need to monitor and review production throughout the life of the product. The direct LVD now says if it's a high risk product, where there's a high volume, high risk sample of production, so you're taking samples off the production and re-testing them, re-examining them to ensure they conform to type. If you make changes, you need to update your technical file with changes. If those changes are critical, then you need to sign and redate the declaration of conformity. Quite often, if you ask for D's of C's, or go and have a look at them on the internet, and you'll find declarations of conformity signed 5, 10 years ago for product. The chances are that product has actually changed. D's of C's are not a one hit, oh, I've done my design review, I've tested it, I've put the product on the market. Every time that technical file changes, the declaration of conformity should be re-signed and dated to show that you have updated the file, because that's what it means. The declaration of conformity is your declaration. You have met all of the requirements of the directive for the products you shipped on that day. So if you change the file, the DFC needs to change. So you need to watch dates of standards, dates of directives, make sure those are correct. So, high quality documentation gives you confidence in your product. It's evidence that you're in control. You've got something to control it against, which is a good start. You identify the critical parts that need to be monitored over time. So you don't need to worry about the non-critical components. That's a functionality thing. But from a safety bit, you can say, right, I've got half a dozen safety critical parts and materials which I do not under any circumstances change, which I always make sure I've got enough stock of parts to keep my production going, because I can't alter those. And high quality documentation also gives confidence to the supply chain. If you produce a file which has just got top level information in it, it's actually got no trade secrets in it at all. It's giving no more away than you probably would put in your instruction book. So you could share that with a key potential customer. If you're selling business to business and someone says, oh, well, you know, I'd love to buy from you, you can say, well, I can prove that I'm fully compliant. You know, have a copy of my technical file. Remembering all the technical detail is buried away in your own files. So do have a think about that. Remember, it alleviates risk. This is your first line of defence. If someone picks the phone up and says, I'm from the HSE and I have had a complaint against your product that it's electrocuted someone or burnt down someone's factory, then, and I'd like to see your technical file, please. You can go, yeah, that's fine, technical file's there. You know it can't be you because you've done everything properly and you've got the evidence to prove it, save you some sleepless nights. And be aware, as I've said many times this morning already, there are clear penalties for incorrect documentation. It's more important than ever that this is absolutely right.